Sorry, yeah, just go ahead. Well, looking at this case, it is, seems like any other case that happens, you know, we hear about this in and out in court very often. And I think one of the most landmark legislations that was here was the Right to Information Act. It empowered the citizens to invoke the act, and it is really far-reaching. I think it addressed issues for the citizens. It addressed issues for the government, it for institutions as such, and it addressed issues for the employees. And when I say that, when it addressed issues for the employees, it meant that there was an answerability from their side. In case they did not follow the processes, they were negligent, or they were in connivance, or they, whatever other reasons, they were looking for bribes, there was a sanction imposed on them. And that kind of brought a sense of answerability. So looking at all of that, we see that in the recent trend in the last few years, I think the invoking of the act has gone down. There hasn't been, I mean, there's been a lot of setback because there were RTI activists who were killed, who went through major issues there. And the judiciary did play an active role. They have been good judgments. In fact, recently the Supreme Court has held that the RBI is a public authority which is answerable. But then we have other wings of the government as well. So there may be a legislation which may come into place which may put back what the judiciary has done. There was a case where the income tax authorities were asked to reveal information. And we fought the case for almost like 7 years. And we got the judgment finally. And then there was a change in the legislation. So you're put back. And I think as one of the speakers had earlier mentioned, it's important that there's an integration of the various bodies in the government. It's very, very important. Now, some of the things that I just wanted to flag out, which I feel is important for ACA to do, I think they've made a very important and a very big initiative. I think it's very, very key today. Some of the things that is required is, I think, domain expertise. There is very few investigation agencies that you can reach out to do a good, thorough investigation. And in fact, investigation should not be done after the fraud has occurred, but there should be investigation throughout. There should be proactively, your evidence should be built much before. I mean, any transaction could convert into a fraud at any point of time. So you should have your documentation, which is very, very thorough, and it should be well investigated and kept. One of the biggest things we face in court today is that there are photocopies of documents which are fraudulent. I do a lot of IPR cases. I see trademark certification and registrations which are fake. Copyright registrations which are superimposed and brought into court. And the implications are far-reaching because they could take an ex parte stay based on those documentation. An ex parte stay means the other guy's business is completely stopped for a number of years till the judiciary decides the other way. So it's very, very important that we build up expertise. There should be forensic experts, there should be cyber experts, there should be software auditing experts. I don't think auditing firms are equipped to handle software licensing arrangements. They just don't understand the techno-legal issues that are involved. And one of the biggest fears that I have in court when I go into court to argue a matter is, what would I do if the other side has brought up fraudulent documentation? I can't prove my case. I can't do anything against that. So I think some of the speakers earlier were discussing about defining what fraud is. I don't think fraud can be ever defined. The lines of fraud have moved on. There was a time when there was the Standard Chartered Bank, the Hiten Dalal scam, which was based on different issues. Today we are facing scams which are based on ATM and based on technology, which is completely different. How will you define fraud? You can't define fraud. It would be based on every circumstances of every case. And fraud is of different nature. In the legal area, fraud is what? There are false affidavits, there are false documentation that are filed. The oath commissioner doesn't look at the documents that come to them. The notary doesn't look at the documents that come to them. They are just authenticated without anybody checking anything. So there are no checks and balances. There's no internal audit that's happening. Unless these things are addressed, I mean, if you go abroad, if you speak to an international client, they will not sign an affidavit unless they are completely sure of what they are signing. They will not move, they will not purchase property unless they've checked the antecedents of the notary public and the oath commissioner. They will check it on the website and be sure who is signing the document. That's how there is some auditing that happens. Here, nothing happens. There are all kinds of dates that are put into documents. So I think it's very important that we build our evidence at every stage, everywhere. I'm sorry, it's a little bit of a legal language, that evidence, but I think that is going to be key in any investigation that is done. And that's probably what I would just say is what I have to say on the case.